clarify. I am a technologist. I have been working into IT for more than a decade now and was with Oracle Financial Services until 2013. Until 2013, I was one amongst you all sitting on either side of conferences, talking, writing codes, analyzing. And that was decent business and I was doing good. It was a lot of new things I was trying out. And in an attempt to try out something really, really new, maybe let's see what happens if I go and take up this option. So I went ahead and I took up something with state government of Maharashtra, and especially rural development. It is something we don't even think of attempting. It is IT that I look at. Initially I stepped into, and it was nothing beyond MIS. It was collecting data, presenting reports, drawing graphics, and slowly I realized that there was lots that government was doing into technology. We're not as bad as we think. So in this presentation, and next 1 hour, that I'm going to try is not talk as a technologist, but I'm representing, I'm not representing government, but I am part of government, having spent 2 years there as a typical pessimist, having a inko kya, that type of attitude. They don't know anything. I entered with that, mental block, and I'm going to share my experience and whatever I have learned over 1.5-2 years time from technology perspective and how it is getting ahead from here and why it matters to all of us. So it's not only about my story, but why it matters to all of us now, why we should be alert, why we should be watching. I think I should be talking something that makes sense to you at the end of the talk, if not now. So, UMED, Maharashtra State Rural Livelihoods Mission, is a program run across the country where I look into the IT. It's called UMED in India, RGB called across, and different names in various states. But it's primarily the last World Bank funded poverty alleviation program. Hence onwards, if we don't become, we are not poverty free country, we're not getting World Bank funding. So that's what it's primarily is. We had so many programs in the past where we got World Bank funding and we wanted to come out of poverty. We did not want to be a poor country anymore, but we, as a matter of fact, are. We do have poverty anywhere, everywhere. Rural is what we try to address in Rural Livelihoods Mission, and there is also a Urban Livelihoods Mission, which also addresses the urban poor, the growing number of urban poor. So that's the soft part of the thing that I take care of, but there is a lot of IT into it as well. And my topic that I chose while I was thinking of this conference is, I was searching a lot on what is happening in smart cities. I myself look forward to development. That's why we all have got a change in the system. We have a different governance now, different people running the government now. We all look forward to development. We have, we expect a lot, right? So we're changing our favorites from A to B to B to A. So that's only in an attempt to have more developed country, because otherwise, as IT, when I do not think of infrastructure or other things in my country, we are very, very ahead of time, right? So ahead of rest of the laws or rest of the countries, so to say. But when we talk about development in-house, we realize that we aren't as ahead as we want to think about ourselves. So I chose smart cities. I chose Internet of Technology because I feel that it is not going to be possible to make a city smart unless there is Internet of Technologies, Internet of Things, IoT. That's something new. I hope everybody here in the room has heard about IoT before, right? I mean, at least IoT, Internet of Things, is a term everybody knows. So I'm not going to elaborate on that. We'll eventually see what it comes to. And then I tried to search a few smart cities. Now our government is saying we're going to be having 100 smart cities in India in the next 7 to 8 years. I want to be living in one of them, of course I want to. So where are current smart cities across the world now? You see, US, United States, as we would presume, most of Western Europe, some cities in Middle East. I am sorry, I couldn't get a clearer and a sharper map than this. Eastern Asia, Singapore, part of Australia, yes, in this list, because they have a big 107 cities across the globe, so they do have Hyderabad, Jaipur, and Bangalore for certain reasons being included into, because they do have technology aspect. I see this primarily takes into consideration the use of information, communication, technology in the governance and in the running of a city. So that is the reason why you have Hyderabad, Bangalore, Jaipur sitting up there. But then we don't see much presence in. Out of 107, which was stored in 2012, we won't have all of them in India, 100 in India in next 8 years. Imagine what is that we want to do. What all has happened all across the world is what we want to do in next 7-8 years in India. So we should be watching. I'll go on with the specific project. And so now, what is this smart city all about? It's a big hype. Any ideas? Anybody wants to take a guess? What is this smart city? What is the dream of a smart city? Most of the things are automated, of course. Yes, that's very much what it's going to be. So, it's going to be smart. Smart in terms of, see, it's a relative term. I am smarter than somebody means. I'm doing something more efficiently, in a better fashion. It's relative. So we want some cities to be not smart and some to be smart. Means some cities to be doing things more efficiently in terms of resources that they have. In terms of time that they have. So cities need to urbanize fast, accommodate to the urbanizing needs fast, and for that probably they use technology. So smart city per se does not directly mean a technologically advanced city. It primarily means a city which is smarter than the other cities in similar setup, probably. So here we're talking about city using its resources time smart, and that is where probably technology is going to help city to be smarter, understand what the set of resources are, how they are utilized, and then maybe manipulate or tell how effectively can that be used. So we are already hearing about smart homes, smart transportations, right? We are talking about, now we have timer-based traffic signals all across, but we don't want to see a traffic signal which functions on the basis of traffic load that is on either side of the signal. That's a simple thing that we want to expect. We want to have a predictable transport system, and that is what our government is planning, it's promising at least. And that is happening all across the world. Wherever we're going, in Singapore, it's so predictable that that is what gives you comfort. Right? So that is what we're targeting. Healthcare, healthcare is already quite advanced with especially wearable devices. It is, of course, white technology intervention is there. In addition to that, we are making it very, very personalized, wherein you have certain sensors all around you, in your houses, in the places you generally stay, and that detect how you're doing on health-wise. If you need continuous monitoring, it's monitoring you and telling your primary service provider maybe. That's what Tarun was telling yesterday, right? So you have sensors within you, outside you, and that detects your heart rate, any, or maybe your diabetes, what sugar level, and alerts your physician immediately. So that's kind of things we've already seen happen. There's nothing new in that. And that is what we want to happen here as well. But we want it to happen at a much larger scale. It's not the elite, the top 1, top 2, top 3% that we're talking about, right? It's the entire set of people inhibiting that location or that part to use those set of services. That means it needs to become part of civic society, needs to become part of the civil services that we have. Of course, healthcare, school, IT, and things like that. Then the other set of smart cities that we primarily see in Europe, unlike in rest of the non-Europe, like these are the energy and the environment aware smart cities. If you talk about Barcelona, if you talk about Vienna, you talk about Amsterdam. They are recycling their energy. They're so energy efficient. They have zero carbon emission, or few of them are targeting zero carbon emission somewhere down the line. We can't consider global warming or distant thing. If somebody in India is made to speak, Prime Minister of the country speaks in front of the world, is made to speak in front of the world, that we are conscious about global warming, we care about our carbon emissions, then we better get working on it. We have to start working on the carbon emissions that we're doing. We're not bothered about it currently. Nobody's asking you how much carbon are you emitting today. But soon that's going to happen. We have to watch on that. We do plan to, not sure what is our plan here on energy efficiency, on environment efficiency. We're not planning it that well, but we do want to do that really well, because we currently have a very big energy deficit. as a country, as an urban part of the country, has a very big deficit in meeting that, and then planning it out well is going to be a big challenge for them. Our economy currently is based IT based. I don't know, we would, as a technologist, IT professional, I would love to believe that. But then it may not. Our governance of smart governance, a reliable governance, is part of a smart city. Primarily what it all means is improved living. And I'm not sure if anybody has, any of you has got time to catch up with today's finance minister's budget speech. I mean, the second or third sentence he said was, we want to improve living. So if we are improving living, we are going to be making things smarter. Making things smarter means, of course, if we are staying in cities, our cities are going to be smarter. But that also means that there are going to be a lot of checks on us. We're going to have loads and loads of systems, putting lots and lots of sensors all around. How many of us, you know, at this moment, or you know, have direct interaction with sensors? How many of us are comfortable with the only idea of being surrounded by sensors all around? As a Puneite, I'm not. I'm very, very concerned. That's the upbringing that I have. And I am not. Be very grateful. That is the reality we're going to be living in. We will have sensors all around us. And I, whether I choose or not, as a person, as people, we will have to use these sensors, use these systems, we'll have to share, we'll have to crowdsource. When it comes to crowdsourcing, a sweet word feels very good. Oh, I'm willing to share, I don't mind. I'll crowdsource something, I want to contribute to social segment, I want to do some social responsibility with society is what I am, right? So you see, we got to be part of all this, and there is no choice out of it. So we better start getting a little alert. So when I say smart cities, again, Internet of Things, why? You know, we're just getting smarter, right? We're not talking about anything else. So let's put some three or four systems in place. Have cleaner. In Pune, we don't need much. We need clean, predictable transportation. Maybe we need a little pure air. And a third demand, maybe, you know, better health care or something, and we'll be good as a city. That is what we probably would want to say. I don't want to get into IoT or, but that's not a choice. Because why any smart implementation, even if it is a smartphone, when it scales up in the length and the breadth, as you know, when it larger scale, number of people and larger type of things happening. So when both of them widen up, you have a variety of things that come into place. Now, I'm not sure if this is readable at the back, but what we're talking about is, yeah, we have service providers, the number two network service providers that are already in place. And we take that for granted that we have decent network service providers. They'll keep improving over a period of time. We'll have better and better network services coming up. We do have small vendors giving up wearable or small set of products which have these detect technologies. So maybe the cameras or the wearable devices, some sensor-based parking. So these will be some independent things which function independently also. But then there will be two different sets where we as technologies, we as software programmers, or these IT hardware software, these primarily sit into is the service providers. We are going to be part of this managed service providers. We are going to be consuming this data. If I don't consume it, who else is going to consume it? If I don't monitor, if there is nobody sitting at the other end monitoring, analyzing this information, what sense does it make to anybody else? So yes, I am going to be part of this. I am going to be the service provider, or probably when these small sets are independent, small smart home, smartphone, and all other things independently are smart, integrating them together to make a smart function. When I say smart city or smart building or smart premises, smart healthcare. So there's a lot of integration. Various things need to talk to each other. So that integration would also be provided by IT people. Right? So we are going to be part of it. And this is happening really, really soon. It's not, 10 years from now, it's not happening that late. And that is why we, if you look at this, here, what are we doing? We're connecting things. And that is why primarily does not just remain, more aware networks, it becomes internet of things, but things start communicating to each other. And as I know, now to believe, internet of things is a different version of internet, where no, the one we have is internet of people, and that is internet of things. But if we go by correct predictions and what, how people are envisioning this growing, Harvard Business Review says that first technology evolution happened when we were able to talk between computer, client and a server. So you could automate things, and that was the first level of things that changed the way businesses started operating. You were automating. The next evolution happened with the entry of internet, where the geographical location made no difference to this entire automation. It could be automated from any part, executed anywhere, and still the business would run the same way. So the internet was second thing, and internet of thing is the third thing happened, the third evolution. So it's going to be big. It's going to be a lot of things happening across length and breadth, a lot of parallel embedded devices, and lot of data as well created out of it. And why? That is why any project as small or big as smart city or any technology project would mean internet of thing to us. Some IoT projections until last year. This is not clear. We're here somewhere. I mean, around 10 billion devices as of today. We're talking about devices which are connected cars, the wearables, everything is taken into account. What do we talk? Right from your smartphone, your computers, your tablets, your TVs, your wearables, your connected cars. So if this is where we are, around 10, 12, in a 4 years' time, there's a projection that we need to be going around 35, where around 25 billion devices would be Internet of Things. And if you want to say that, okay, it's going to be sensors, so of course, number to body jagger, it is going to be much larger. It's not sensors. We're talking about the entire product per se, or Internet of Thing device solution per se. So that is a realistic, that's a projection that is being made. Now, if AI intelligence says so, even other agencies are projecting something similar. There is a projection that by 2020, we'll have 50 million Internet of Thing devices all around the world. So it's big business. All the big market holders today, especially some six segments, are trying to delve into IoT. I've myself heard of all the telecom providers saying, I have IoT platform. All the telecom providers across the country today say they have consortiums, they have lots of import, lot of things going on. And they will say, I have an IoT platform. They don't even understand what it means. I mean, that is what I have thought. But then, they all are saying, I have IoT offering, I have Internet of Things offering. That means everybody is getting into this, everybody is doing, and those are the clients we serve, right? Now, with Internet of Things in place, so many things consuming data, we have certain questions to ask. And no, till this moment, I know everybody is disconnected. Now, start visualizing a world where I am living, where everything around me is talking about me, and I have no control over the devices. Do I control what my smartphone sends to another device? No, I don't. Now, when a smartphone is beyond my control, I do have a consent. I do say, yes, I am ready to share these information. And that is when it shares that. But I don't control that. Now, when the number of such things, devices, machine-to-machine communication increases, the amount of data flowing is definitely increasing, and it's a good news for big data guys, because then we are analyzing more data, we have lots and lots of business for big data, we have a lot of things to do. But now, if it's a lot of data, who's controlling it? You would be, I mean, what would the answer, who owns data in Internet of Things? Who would own that? We don't want to answer that. Who would own that? No takes? No, please help me understand, because even I am exploring all this. It's not there for ages, so it's pretty new.
Ideally, it's the kind of contract the consumers have.
So currently, nobody owns. Nobody is saying, I don't own the data. As a consumer, I would always love to believe that I own the data. After all, it's my name. How can you own my name? How can a device sitting, my Wi-Fi router own my name?
Yeah,
It can't, right? It is me. It is my name. It is my date of birth. It is my PAN card number. It is my Aadhaar card number. It is, I'm not talking passwords. I'm talking about data here. Okay? So all these data is what I own. It is my data. But the moment it gets into devices, we have to really define who owns it. So far, we haven't defined it really, really clearly. Some places, yes, it is said that consumer owns, but unless I have a clear definition of who owns, it's going to be very difficult. Okay, owning is one part. Does owning mean controlling? If I want to control my data, if I do not want to tell a signal, or if I have a variable, but I don't want to share that signal with anybody else, I don't want to share that data with anybody else, then I am having no good use of the device that I have. Okay, that's something, maybe I made a choice and that is why I should share. But suppose I do not make a choice for traffic signal. I'm not choosing which traffic signal I will pass through. I want the city to function nicely. I do not choose what bus I go on. Well, if it's a smart bus, if it's a predictable transport system, probably it's capturing my data. And then in that case, do I control what data is getting in the system? No, just consent. Just because I am giving written consent saying yes, I agree to share this data, doesn't mean I control it. And again, the topic that I started off first with data privacy. When it comes to privacy, we don't even want to discuss what is private and public. Right? So it's as private as that. When it comes to data, yes, I own my data. I'm very, very particular about what is private to me. My private data, my data privacy will always mean the same to me, irrespective of any level of development in the technology. So no matter where the technology goes, no matter how improved, how good dream you show me, but I want to have some privacy aspect to my data. I don't want to share everything. Okay? And then, while I'm doing this, now you are saying, I mean, good, Pune is not in that list. I'm so happy. No? Pune is not in the first list of smart cities. So this is not a happening in Pune. I mean, nothing good about it. We have to eventually make a choice between, do you want things to work a little more efficiently? Or is it about privacy, controlling? I mean, it's not exactly, they're not contradicting. But looking at this stage of thinking that we are in, whatever I have brought you into, maybe it seems a question between where do I get between efficiency and privacy? Where do I get between how usable I want, how easy I want it to be to heterogeneous? Suppose I have 10 different devices. Now, how many of you have changed your Wi-Fi router default password? Not all of us, right? Yes, few of us have. How many of us have changed all the default passwords of devices we had? Are we sure? Some of the devices do not even tell that they have a default PIN, they have a default value for this, that, your, no? They don't even tell. Whenever I am being said, oh, this is default, please change, I do and go and make a point to change. Sometimes I don't even know there's a default value for that particular thing there. And and suppose I have 10 different things. How many times do we end up having same password for two different things? How many of you claim that you do not have same password repeated anywhere, not even twice? I have some passwords repeated, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that is what, I can't remember so many passwords, so many key codes, so many pins. So I tend to put some sense to it and repeat them across common set, not common set, or whatever. I'll have some logic to it. So then that is for my user friendliness, my usability, so that I'm able to use those services. But then that also means that they are same to me. If I repeat same password at so many places, that means if one is hacked, the other one is, there's a likelihood that it might get hacked. I'm not saying it will, but there is a possibility, right? So, a lot of questions. I just try to list a few of them. So that means that if I look at this diagram, if one of the passwords is hacked at one level, the others may be hacked because of Internet of Things, the hacking is no longer about the data transferring over the communication channel. We have opened up everything. Okay? So data is getting collected from your body all the way to cloud. Right? So it's not a single channel, sometimes it's moving all across. So there are sensors which collect data, there's some sensors getting connected in some devices which are processing some part of it or maybe aggregating, putting it all across. There's gateway, there are clouds, all these kind of technologies there. And there are entire spectrum of, the entire width, I would say, where we can hack. Okay, now you don't want to assume that we have a world of hackers. No, we don't. Everybody doesn't hack. I haven't hacked into anything. No, I have. But then, with a purpose, right? With a, I would sort of say that, with a decent purpose of understanding. But then, we are not a hacker community, so we don't hack. What if the information is cross-shared? That can happen, right? Our programs can have bugs, right? So what if it's cross-shared? What if the information doesn't go where it needs to every time? Because assume so many pieces of information flowing all around. So there is always a possibility that it might not go where it needs to reach. And second thing, now we have just in the recent past experienced data selling. We share some data and it's sold to third party. We were so annoyed with it. We got new regulations into place. Then DND and all the stuff came and we're now very happy. My data is not sold, but are we sure about it? That is just one spectrum. The moment we started collecting information, we started seeing value in it. The business started getting generated. Now when big data people, those who are analyzing large volume of data, you want large volume of data to be generated, to be collected, so that you get your money for bread and butter, right? So who's going to generate that data? We ourselves generate that amount of data, and when it's getting generated, it's moving all across, there is very much likelihood that it can be used for different purposes than what I initially thought it would be used for. My name, the very, very simple details can be of different significance. PAN card we know, otherwise it means nothing. But PAN card, to IRS or to tax services means very different thing. If it goes into those services, a lot of things can be hacked. About our passwords, all our financial, not banking passwords, I'm talking about all the financial reports that you get. Your tax returns, your all bank account statements. What passwords do we use? What passwords? I put on those PDF files. They are first few letters of our names, our date of birth, maybe such simple things, right? So it becomes with access to some piece of information, a lot of things can be done. Right? So it's not that it doesn't matter to me if somebody knows my name. It matters to me if somebody knows my name and doesn't have a good intention of using it. Right? So even knowing my name can cause harm to me if somebody wants to use it with that intent. So there are different kind of attacks that are going to happen. And take this as a reality that it is happening. It's just that that's what's being talked around the world. Those talking about data security in Internet of Things are saying that we better design our systems, better be prepared and not wait for first attack to happen. Are we going to start acting when first smart city system goes down because of a grid, electrical grid, shut off because of a simple hack? Is that what we're waiting for? Or transport system put to halt? This is like all the science fiction movies that we see. And that's happening. That's so much easy to happen now. Right? So we don't want to wait until then. And that is why maybe I'm sitting and talking, trying to keep you all awake that this is happening. So with Internet of Things, I see the certain challenges because of it. It's not only the large spectrum of attacks. Yes, we have more points to attack. We are more prone to hacks. But even in regular business, even if things, so many smart things start operating, so many small automated, forget smart, we don't want to call them smart, they are causing so much harm to us, let's not call them smart. So if so many things start capturing information about, suppose I have a Wi-Fi router and I have a sensor in my house which detects a leakage, a smart water supply system will have a sensor somewhere or a water leakage thing near your water meter. And if you don't have water meter like we have in Pune, you will have a water meter and a sensor next door. Right? So then your Wi-Fi router and your water meter, if you are accessed, you can access that water meter through your Wi-Fi router. A lot of things can change across. It's not about supply for your house, but it's also about the pattern that you live into. That will also tell when you stay at house, when you don't stay at house. That kind of compromises your daily routine, which you otherwise don't want to share, a lot of information about you, which you otherwise don't share, right? So things like that are going to happen. There is a lot of data that is going to be generated, that is going to be collected, that is going to be shared across the network, and then that will create value. I'm not saying that's useless data, right? So out of 10 different formats, unstructured data, we collect all that and try to make sense. So all this definitely is value, right? It is all people's data, so it definitely would be helpful. But now there are a few more challenges. When I say all this, we are thinking of this to be an open ecosystem. These functions, these systems can't work in solo. Internet of Things does not exist if machines do not talk to machines, if they do not become smart, if they do not get the cognitive skills. If my machine stays there and just keeps capturing and does not result into any activity, kind of prohibitive activity or some cognitive activity, if there is no action taken based on that data, then there is no smartness to it. Right? So I am expecting that kind of activity to happen. Maybe my fridge detecting that I have eaten a lot of cheese or maybe not nutritious food, you know, not allowing it to supply to other section of the food. This can happen. Even there are a lot of blogs. It's not about hacking, it's reality, right? My nutrition taken care by my fridge with a smart system in place, my smart television deciding. I want my television to decide what my child sees, what it does, what child doesn't get to see. But there could be other things as well. And these things will function only when we have an open ecosystem. A smart TV talking to a smart Wi-Fi, talking to maybe another system hooked into my machine or my house, a smart door phone. So with open ecosystem, they need to trust each other. They are wider and more prone communication channels. Now, what this also means is that because we have more communication channels, more devices talking to each other, there's a whole lot of permutation and combination of communication channels that are going to be in place. And my entire security system will be as secure as the weakest link in the system. So if that link goes down, the entire system is, I can kind of enter into it. This also results into, or can result into, a domino's effect. By that we mean that suppose one sensor or one set of thing is hacked into. Suppose a water meter, for this example, or an electricity meter is hacked, or an electric bulb on the electricity meter is hacked to identify some information. Now, same thing can hack the entire cluster of electricity meters because it's all put into a grid. They don't have a security when they communicate with same thing. So it's a brother relationship, isn't it? The exchange that happens between that entire cluster isn't with a security framework. So that entire cluster gets hacked and you get access to the entire cluster. So that's the domino effect. And then that's more challenging. There are a lot of examples of a coffee machine getting hacked and providing information about, yes, from a coffee machine, we get an access about what's there in the parking lot, what are the times the person enters the house, what's the time the person exits the house. So it's, and these are real-time examples that we're talking about, just one or two. You can anytime Google, with one thing getting hacked, how the access, because we're connecting these through Wi-Fi, right? So it isn't as difficult as we think it would be. Now, a lot of these systems will not have a user interface and cannot. So, your Wi-Fi router, we do have a web page or link where we configure. But many other systems will not have a user interface at all. They cannot. They don't need to have a user interface at all. That means, how do you access those systems as a user? How do I interface with that system? I do not. Maybe I directly do not need to. It is pre-configured. I'm not supposed to be using it. But that also means I do not know what is happening inside that system. I assume a lot of things are going right or wrong in that system. So no user interface is going to be a big challenge there. Compatibility of devices in the system. Now, if anybody has a smart watch or has tried to buy one, the same, at least the current market scenario, so that if you have a smart watch, it is compatible with the same company smartphone, right? So Samsung smartwatch runs with Samsung smartphone, iPhone one runs with the iPhone one and all that. That probably is also because it's in a sense secure. But then, yeah, that's it. Look, goddammit, I admit that it's not secure. It is about incompatibility. Devices do not have standard protocols to communicate, and that is why they communicate only in the language that the two of them understand. They've coded the thing so well that exchange directly happens between the two devices and cannot so easily happen between the other devices, because there are no common interfaces written there. So there is no common interface, there is no common protocol between devices across, you know, the spectrum. There is no, now we are talking about operating systems for smart mobile devices. With Internet of Things or the embedded technologies people, is there an operating system we operate on? No, we haven't heard of an operating system on which these smart embedded, we do have the language for embedded technologies, right? We do have that. But we are not thinking of an operating system where you, do they not need to operate? Yes, they do. They have a computing skill. They do have computing capacities. These devices are going to be computing. So they probably would need an operating system down the line. Currently, they don't. And the challenge is more difficult because the failures here can be life-threatening. Assume a failure in a healthcare system. It can result. If a wrong signal is passed, the same, my signal is passed to somebody else, if it is not passed at all, it can be a life-threatening situation. So because we're talking about things saving our life, making our life easier, they can at times make our life difficult as well. So that's what makes it tough. There is going to be an assumption that all these devices that I buy, I pay money for, they have to be 100% reliable. I can't take it for granted that any of them is going to make an error. I do not want the device. So it's the fault tolerance that we were talking about yesterday. There is zero fault tolerance in these devices. After all, they're products. They have to function fine. But how do we guarantee that about the software products that we make? That they're fault tolerant. They might be fault tolerant, but they're zero defect. They don't have any exceptions or they, any cases where they do not fail. We don't make that guarantee. And these devices are going to use our computing skills. I am the one who's going to write programs for all this. We are together going to make all this work. We are going to write programs for all these devices. And then, how soon are we going to, get into this, the mindset of reliability, zero defect, assuming there is, providing complete fault tolerance, any situation it handles carefully. That mindset needs to be, it's currently not there, it needs to come in. Most of the devices are very small. The embedded devices do not have any computing power or very less. If you talk about MB storage or memory speed that they have, so they hardly can process anything. And that makes it a challenge because security frameworks, security algorithms that we have in place, or whatever it needs to even communicate that this is not an usual activity, would need more computing speed, space, would also mean more memory. And I do not have enough memory. I'm a very small device. So I might not have enough memory to even accommodate the security thing that I'm talking about. So it's going to be very difficult with the limited computing speed or computing capacities that these devices will have to provide enough space for security, enough space for compatibility, enough space for reliability. So many exceptional cases that we're talking about. So how do we secure this? And this is one of the definitions that I've taken. That means we together have to come up with a data handling framework. There is no way around. I've highlighted some words where we have to, this is the definition of how, or maybe approach through which we can secure the Internet of Things. We have to establish trusted relationship, not between people, but between devices, which are there for the entire spectrum of the device, the entire life cycle. I'm not talking about initially authenticate and then go. It's not about in the beginning, in the end, every time you reboot. I'm talking about some trusting mechanism throughout the execution period, throughout the execution on, off, whatever, as long it exists. It needs to have a trusted relationship with every other thing that exists. We have to have control over not just the data, but also sources from where it's being captured and who's consuming this. So the consumer and how it moves up down the chain. So there's so many things we need to control. So data needs to be controlled even at the source, and the consumer's data at various stages needs to be protected. So entire framework, we should handle it more responsibly. The way we take care of our children, nobody needs to teach me parenting. Right? So we know how to take care of that. So similar kind of care, caution needs to be taken. If we want to own this responsibility of being a technology country or technology industry, then we need to start taking also, you know, be a little more aware, a little more, you know, responsible with the way we handle data, the way we collect data, the way we aggregate data, the way we analyze data. At various stages, it needs to happen a little more responsible. Some common things we would definitely think about is, we will need access control here, yes. We need account management, you'll have multiple accounts, no cross-sharing, where you can see, where you can't see, you still have accounts, you still have access controls. For devices, we don't have a user interface. How do you do it? Yes, you do, you still do it. Maybe somebody else does that for you. It comes pre-configured, but that needs to happen. Some access control needs to be in place. So some common things which all of us know, which already exist. We'll have to have segregation of networks. Everything on Wi-Fi doesn't remain in the same net. There are a lot of segregation, a lot of network splits that needs to happen. Special channels need to be devised. We need to use more secure protocols. Are we always communicating over secure protocols? They are into existence. Are we always communicating? No, we're not. So we need to maybe, not always, but wherever we see data moving, we need to start using that as a practice. Firewall, antivirus updates, very simple thing. But how many of us have a firewall at home? Not all of us, right? So, you know, do we plan to even get one? Or do I, you know? So, are we thinking that way? Do I want to get a smart TV first or a firewall first? So, again, the device providers need to, you know, they have to do a mind switch. Most of these IoT devices do not have remote updates. They need to be hooked into something for an update because they don't have that computing for one thing. And secondly, they're not designed that way. They're kind of designed for a short-term use. So they need to have, if they are hacks, if there are changes, same device computing cannot, or the program cannot continue to function all its life. There are going to be changes into it, depending on the situation. So they need to be remotely updated. Otherwise, you can't expect people to remove the devices off the network, hook them to the computer, and get them updated. That can't happen. So this is one strong thing that has to become as a practice. And we, as technologists, have to take this practice. How many times do we devise our programs so that they're so independent, what Arun was talking last morning, that they are microservices where they completely execute independently. No, unless we devise them that way, they cannot be remotely updated. And as a mindset, no, this slide is my prime purpose of being here, that we have to start thinking differently. We as technologists, how many of our teams have security experts? Yes, one of the team there. We have to start thinking security center, security first, user first, because he is the one for whom we're devising. And I am the user of all the IoT things. Till now, most of the things that I was devising, I could or I could not be user of that. But now, with so many programming happening for these devices, you eventually would end up using that program yourself, if not directly, indirectly, somewhere in the pipeline. Okay? So if you are going to be consumer of that program, and it is your security at risk, your privacy at risk, you better take care of that right from the moment you conceive that thought. So it needs to become part of our small teams that we're thinking about, the poly-skill teams, that everybody thinks security. It's not about being conserved. It's just giving priority to security first. Security of data, if not the entire thing, at least think about where the data is moving and know what all can be done with it. So a lot of things can be done first. First, the mindset change, prioritizing security over speed to market. I am sure Gaurav will agree with this, that everybody in IoT wants to reach market first. I am the first one providing this. And that's what the scenario today is. They want to say, I am the only provider and the first one giving you the service. But that may not be so secure. So as a consumer of the service and as a service provider, I have to make a judgment there. I should give priority to security before reaching market first. If my thing is not well thought through, I might as well hang on, give it that touch, and then maybe released in the market. Security considerations have to become part of product design. These are not just recommendations, they are hardcore things that we need to learn now. It's high time, the volume is too big, it's 25 million devices coming all around you in 4 years' time, so it's going to be too huge for us to even ignore it. Security teams, IoT security teams, experts, that means all of us should look at this as a career alternative. No? Can I become a security expert? No? What is the scope for being one? We need a whole lot of team who expertise in security. We have to partner with firms which have that expertise. Vendors have to collaborate. Now, cars, the previous beautiful session, I know that was not as as boring as this one, but then, because that was quite hands-on, you could experience what was happening. I failed to create that experience, I believe. So, that previous session, we're talking about was a car computer. And in that session, we're talking about cars advancing using Internet of Technology, Internet of Things, advanced technology. That's happening. That's practically happening. Cars are the first one. Automobile is the first adopter of IoT after telecom. So when cars are becoming so adaptive, so smart, my cars are computing everything, not just telling insurance provider, but also telling me to drive it smartly, right? I mean, I get so many things on my car, and very good models have much more features out there. But are the car vendors talking to each other? No, they're not. There is an International Integration Consortium for automobiles. It is IIAC, and Ford, BMW, Audi, General Motors, all are members of that. But all of them have their proprietary protocols to communicate between the devices. So they're not talking. They're not still sharing, still talking about what needs to be exchanged. They're just coming together. Yes, at least they're coming together. No? It'll start up from there. But they're not talking. They're not cross-sharing. They're not, that is not happening. We're not collaborating between vendors. It's not mechanical collaboration or electromechanical collaboration that we're talking about. Here we're talking about data collaboration, right? Do we want to land up into a situation where an accident happens and only BMW cars identify that, the rest of them? Do not. We don't want to have to land up in that situation, right? So they need to share data, technology, a lot of things, collaborate together to secure environment, to cross-share. Now, in the previous slide, we're talking about standards. So let's take a look at what are the recent standards. We would always assume, all of you can tell me, no, you don't know, there are a lot of standards there. Yes, there are lots of standards there. We have a standards for Wi-Fi. All of this is going to communicate probably in Wi-Fi, RF, Bluetooth, right? So, Wi-Fi, 802.11ac, that's most recent one. It's probably redefined for Internet of Things. That's how IEEE standards says that this is the one they've written for things, embedded things communicating. And it's a very high speed, so 5G is happening on this standard. All the 5G devices. 4G is what we are trying to use. 5G is already happening, and it's going to use this standard 802.11ac. Does this standard talk about security? Yes, it does. Does it give center to security? No, it doesn't. So standards are moving into where we want to get. We want to get there fast. Standards are giving you more speed. 5G is going to be faster than 4G. Definitely much, much, much more data transfer over network, right? But standard is not taking care of what happens to my data in certain scenarios. Right? So that's standard does not always mean being more secure. Yes, it is at least thinking, but it is not taking care of that completely. The standard does not really have a security thing in place. What it says is government needs to regulate. So same thing for RF bandwidth. Yes, there is for this small computing speed devices, there is a different crypto, algorithm, different encryption algorithm being written, which is being used. But again, that needs to be revisited, made more effective, more efficient. We can't rely on one or two things here. So a lot of things need to happen. The standards need to be more security-centric, more focused in that way. So what changes do we want to see? We need a finer privacy policy. First of all, we need to identify that there is something called privacy policy beyond what is written on the website. Right? So there is a lot of privacy associated with every form of data. I am okay with my name, my address being used in postal department, but not okay with that being used somewhere else. It's private to that segment. So it's as simple as that. No? All the information that I share in public domain does not become accessible to everybody in every context. So things need to be, these complex things need to be defined now. So privacy policy needs to be defined. Security standards need to be revisited. We have to have more regulation, more compliance. I know all of us have these solutions. More legal framework. But what's world doing about? Is it India who needs to do this first? Entire world is using technology. You go to any city in the world, they're so advanced. They must have done something about it. Why are you so worried? Yes, some parts of the world are doing something about it. But we together need to do a lot about it. Why so? I'll talk about US first. But why so? It's also because what Tarun said yesterday. When things come in India, probably we're not going to do all the steps that other countries did. We're not going to do step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, and then step 5. We probably would leapfrog to step 5 directly. And then, as a system, are we prepared? I don't mean government only owns the entire control thing. We also have a lot of role to play in it. And that is why I'm talking in front of technology people and not in front of academicians or maybe in front of some mechanical engineers. I'm talking about people who are generating data, who are going to aggregate this data, who are going to deal with this data at some or the other step. So you are going to be at least generating this data, if not doing anything. So you should be aware that what is happening on across and what is that I need to do. I don't have 10 years time. I don't think we have 10 years time. We can't fail very badly, and then start learning from there. What has US done is US decent communication channels. US has recently, 15 days ago, has launched a separate security alliance. Right? They had a national security agency. Then what was the need? That was taking care of cyber security. We thinking about cyber wars, right? I mean, we think that that's possible. But they have launched a separate security segment, national security team altogether, which is going to look into not just cyber security, but also this IoT related, the technology redefinitions, regulations, compliances checks, monitoring, the framework change that is needed when we are putting in more devices around the network. So what needs to be done? They're just starting. It's not even 2-3 weeks old. So we also need to do we even have a national security cell which looks into cyber security? Yes, we, so to say, have a cyber crime division in our, but do they look at the entire cyber security spectrum the way the rest of the world does? What is China doing? Do we even know? We don't know. What is Europe doing? Europe is more conservative. They are not only talking about internal agencies, they are collaborating quite widely. They are setting very conservative standards between themselves. They, from the very beginning, are not urbanizing very. It's not about getting there fast. So they do very slow. They have actually got chance to do it over here. So they've done it fine in many, many places, as in Barcelona for that matter, or Amsterdam for that matter. Have done a lot of things very carefully. The rest of the world is where we fall. And we would love to believe, I can speak there at length on China, Japan, Australia, but Japan is doing something. China is not sharing what it is doing. So, India, and what is now the other part of my talk which also interests you is, what is government doing about all this? Isn't it supposed to do all this? And what is smart city in India means? It means that we are going to be doing all, but what have we done with the previous projects? The previous projects that we have done, how many of us have Aadhaar cards? All of us are most? Yeah, the UIDs, the unique ID. Even today's the budget speech said that we are going to have unique the social security system needs to be in hand. That means UID is back into picture, right? So UID, how comfortable were we with the data capture? I know I have run out of time. Just give me 5 minutes, I'll find out. So how comfortable were we with the data capture? Do we know our data is secure? Now, I luckily don't have any policy honks here sitting. Few patrons would have interrupted me saying, yes, we have data security here, because Indian government has regulation of not letting the country data, as whatever the public domain data, government data, outside the geographical limit of the country. We do not let data flow outside the geography. Does that mean if my information stays within my house, it's secure? That's the mental block we are sitting with. We have geographical limitations. We have NICSI, an entire organization sitting and monitoring what flows out of the country and what flows inside the country. So all the data is monitored there. But what about the data sitting within the country? Is it, do we have expertise to manage the volume of data, 1.2 billion people? We do not. We need to ask for, so maybe we as a group, are, no, the policy honks, are going to be advocating for foreign FDI investment into data security or data management for the country. The UID project was done, okay. Data handling there, I do not want to really read it, but it wasn't, it isn't as secure as we would want to assume. I have at times chances of my identity being mismanaged, my lot of information getting mismanaged. They're still not sharing between departments, as in my UID information is not getting shared with the crime department. That's a good news, bad news, God knows. We want to do that, right? But then what will happen if a wrong information gets shared with the right department? Right? I might go to jail. No? I don't know. So that's one thing. We have a lot of online systems coming up. We have so many things. We pay online. We do online certificates. We get online. We go to the, so that's what government is doing. We have open data platform where a lot of data is being thrown in. You should go and check data.org, data.gov.in. Both these sites give you a lot of government data which can be processed. But then, what are the learnings from all this? We do not have a good policy regulation in place. We are not doing great in cybersecurity. And most importantly, how does my government define my privacy? What is my data privacy? There is only two words which call sensitive data in Section 72 of IT Act, which says sensitive data cannot be shared beyond the limit. Now, this sensitive is very limited, right? So, there is nothing private beyond sensitive data. So, this is how private my information is when it gets into civic domain, when it gets into public domain. So, we better be cautious. What's happening? All this alerts me. It excites me, actually. Government turns, a lot of private firms for smart city. The first smart city set up Wi-Fi spot. App is giving free Wi-Fi in Delhi, everywhere. Right? All this is happening. It's not future, it's reality. So slum areas, all of them talking, all the politicians talking about that. We have a draft concept now there. I'll quickly like to walk you through that and then end this. What my definition, what our governance's definition of smart city, what it's going to include is, of course, infrastructure, of course, social services, smart governance. It is going to be financing. They have worked out different financing models, which you all should go and look at how it is going to be, because it is taxpayers' money, which is going in there. It is talking about how to bring all that up, what model, how to maintain it. As we are yelling at tolls, we do not want to yell at anything, traffic signal system tomorrow. So better go and watch that. This is the time. What I'm talking now is this is the time. This is the draft policy. We have all the mechanism through the political framework, through the other agencies framework, where we can voice our whatever we want to. Once it becomes act, then they are amendment, then they are changes. Once it becomes something into implementation, it's very difficult. There is a conference happening in June 2015 where we are inviting countries all across the world to tell us how should we do smart cities. So we have enough time, February. So if we can put our ideas across, of course, policy people are advocating, doing it very hard. But then even as technologists, we should share, we should at least go and read what is going to happen. The operational procedures, benchmarks, policies, and as a matter of surprise, it takes Amanora Pune as a case study. So those staying close by, near Amanora, in Amanora, appreciating Amanora, not appreciating Amanora, should see what my urban development department is looking at smart cities as. What is the case study? Right? So, now, whole lot of things to do. What I want to talk here only about primarily is these two things. Others I think I've spoken at length. This is a German word. I don't know German. So I might have mispronounced that, but what it primarily means is what Europe is doing, what Germany is doing. Collecting data only when it is necessary. Collecting it in very small parts. Collecting only relevant information. And storing only that part which is just necessary to store. So then data, big data wise, we're not going to get a whole lot of data at 10 different places. It's just relevant information that's going to be collected. If I don't collect data, if I don't store data,